All right. And try to keep the pitches under 5 minutes so that we have space to have a discussion for more clarity. The more time you take up, you will have lesser time to give us clarity if we have any questions. So just keep that in mind.
Perfecto. Drop grab. Are you guys here? Anyone from team drop grab?
Written.
Text channel is just above your VC. This is the channel. Just above that, there's like a shark emoji and I have a tank written.
Got it. Got it.
Perfect. Is this drop grab? Is anyone from drop grab?
Okay, drop grab's not here. So we can start it off by a small... you know what? It's 5 minutes. I think we can have a small replay of yesterday in terms of what do you think. So something that Elson, do you think that they need to keep in mind before they start pitching so that before the next one comes in, they have something to keep in mind?
A couple of things. Don't, like, there was one guy who actually, one team, they forgot to, you know, click on the stream and they were just talking and nobody really understood what was happening. And at the end of it, we realized like he had an entire slide prepared, which we didn't get to see. So, you know, try to make sure your technical things are sorted. Number two, when you're coming up with the presentation, try and make it comprehensive. See, we are going to be, I wouldn't say very ruthless, but we would still have like our bitch face on, right? Our resting bitch face on, and we are going to be slightly difficult to impress. So, and that is another thing. Keep it concise. Avoid too much of storytelling is important, but make sure we're also interested in the facts. So, especially when you're preparing like a pitch deck, I hope you guys know that, you know, there are a lot of analysis that you guys have to come up with. For example, retailer analysis or peer analysis, or what is the overall size of the market? Okay, how much money do you actually need? Or what's the amount of funding that you need? What stage are you in? And if you're taking a certain amount of funding, why do you actually need it, right? Explain all of that. After your 5 minutes are over, we'll probably have like
one or two
cross questions. Yeah. Go ahead, sir.
I think the core four things that you need to remember that I need clarity on every time I hear is, what is your business model? What's your revenue model? What's your bifurcation of the investment that you're looking for? And what is the idea buy and hold? Like, you're not able to explain the idea, that becomes very, very difficult. What's the product? Like, don't give me weird analogies and situations. Product kya hai, meri jaan? Like, if you're not able to explain to me what the product is within a sentence, then it's very difficult for me to grab anything else beyond that point, right? Revenue model, business model, what is the bifurcation of the investment that you're asking for? And the moment you give me some absurd numbers, you should be able to back it up. So if you're going to give me absurd numbers in terms of, I'm going to grab this much amount of the market because I know I can, you know you can is not an argument. You get what I'm saying?
Yes, I think I understood. I hope everyone else did. Saad, I think we're good. Let's try and get the first one and then we can.
Yeah.
WebShin, you want to? Is anyone from Team WebShin here? WebTion? No?
No, I don't think Seven Sisters is also here.
Yeah, Seven Sisters. Because I know Seven
Sisters. I know the Seven Sisters guy. Okay. I don't think Seven Sisters is also here. Anyway, I think we can take this on to bring in somebody who hasn't the new pitches. I think this is a perfect opportunity for you guys to pitch. Go ahead and pitch. So, rule number one for coming into pitch like this is you name and then you put it on the Avatank chat so that we know who we are and we'll address you.
While we wait, is there anyone on this list that's actually showed up? Is Z ship here? Z ship?
Z ship, ILG, Education, Cryptogram, Infotech.
Yeah, I'm here. Ashish. Saad.
Hey, Ashish.
Hey, bro. How are you?
Ashish is, if I'm not wrong, Z ship, right?
No, no, CSIP nahi. Crypto ka naam Infotech.
Okay. ILG is not here. ILG, Zshirt, Seven Sisters.
I guess no. I guess what time?
Can I make a question for the team? Okay, then you can go ahead, bro. Then we'll take up the others. I think once we finish the list, then we have enough time to take up the rest. Then we can engage as much as we want. Go ahead.
Sal, you're saying to me, I mean...
Yeah. You can start sharing.
But I can't right now. Second.
So you want to start at 6:50 itself?
No, at least 6:40, I guess. Bill time wo tha na?
Aapka time?
6:40, yeah.
Theek hai, then. Till then, we have... surprisingly, we are on time and this time we have enough time to engage. So if you guys have any questions, we can go ahead and take that till either one of the participants decides to show up.
Anyone from the other two teams, Kofo and SUX Future, are you guys here? Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible, Elsa.
Okay, perfect. I think Saad just dropped off. Anyone from SUX Furniture, Future, why do I keep saying Furniture? Future and Kofo here? Yes, no.
I don't think so. No.
Okay, so I think it's going to be a nice comprehensive one for Cryptogram. Whenever you are ready, in the meantime, you guys have any questions or anything that you wanted to ask? Yesterday we had a lot of questions that we actually couldn't take. Anything that you guys want to ask? And
yeah.
Yeah.
A lot of you already know about my company. Hold on.
What do you guys think about yesterday's pitches? So Saad and I were actually just discussing on which other companies. Anyone who attended yesterday's session, which of them would you find the most promising?
Okay, Helium has this question. The funding which we get, what is the number of shares that Avatank takes?
I don't think Avatank takes any shares. There's nothing in it for Avatank. This is a completely pro bono thing.
Exactly.
So Avatank is not taking anything. It's just that Saad and the Avatank team, they have a strong network. And they're just trying to make it simple for those who are starting off. There's nothing. Yeah. Correct me if I'm
wrong. Yeah, investors take the shares.
It's like when you're giving some money, you need something in return, right? Like you.
Yeah, I mean, it's not the Avatank team that's doing it.
So whoever is giving the funding, what is the like the ratio of the shares that was?
It depends on you, no? It's like you ask for. You need a certain amount of funding, you can ask for that amount of funding, and depending on how much, what stage of the company in, and that's the math you do. And based on that, they will, you'll have to, cuff up whatever equity or debt or whatever it is.
If you can justify any amount, the investors who are coming in are large enough for them to go as high as you can think. Like they have funded enough companies in like good seed rounds and like early series A rounds. So these guys are not, these guys are your proper industrial entrepreneurs. So these guys, and see the advantage of entrepreneurs, so the advantage of these kind of investors is you also need to understand it's their network, right? So you have accessibility to a lot of things. So it's that. So if you can bring a product that is justifiably good, it doesn't matter what your ask is as long as you can defend the ask. बट इफ यू गिव एन आइडिया एंड से मेरे को 50 लाख दो ये आइडिया के लिए बिकॉज इट्स एन आइडिया एंड द आइडिया इज वर्थ दैट मच इट्स स्टूपिड.
Elon Musk has asked a good question. I just want to ask, how do we price a service? Cool. So let me, Saad, do you want to take it or should I?
Sorry, what's the question?
How do we price a service?
How do you price a service? So if it's a service company, I don't know, you go ahead.
Okay, so in terms of pricing, you need to understand this. Two forms of pricing, okay? One is the actual value of a product, and the second thing is a perceived value of a product. Okay, and let me give you a quick example. And this is not technically an investor speak, but you will be able to get the answer of how an investor will look at it. If, say, your Uber, okay, how much does an Uber ride cost you? Say, in Bangalore, to go from point A to point B, it might cost you, a customer will cost you like 100 rupees or 100, 200 rupees, whatever. That you might think that is probably the actual value. But when you're talking about a perceived value, for someone who is like the person like me, if I'm taking that Uber, that I'm getting a lot more from that 100 rupees. I mean, that 100 rupees is not anything for me because one, I don't have to have my bike or car here. Okay. So it's saving me a lot of, like, if I actually have a car, I have to pay in terms of, you know, the maintenance of that car or the servicing, or if in case the occasional repairs are there. So that is, I'm factoring in all of that. What else? I'm saving a lot of time, right? Another thing, like, also in terms of mental, where I am in a mental space, I don't actually invest too much of my attention there. So I can actually, you know, involve myself in another activity. I can probably eat my lunch in the car. I don't know if Uber allows, but you get the point. I can read a book or I can eat something. I don't have to focus so much. So again, I'm saving a lot of time. So this overall for me, that's why, like, maybe 100 rupees or 200 rupees, whatever, it must be more than what an auto ride costs me. But here with an Uber or with all of this convenience where I don't actually have to go down to the bus stop or to the actual place, I'm saving a lot of things. So the perceived value of that Uber is a lot more than its actual value. Okay, so whenever you pitch, you can also come, you also need to understand this. This is what an investor looks in. When you tell him that my product is worth this or my service is particularly worth this much, that is one aspect of it. But you can actually present it saying that perceived value is a lot more. And that is a reason that even if you're charging something higher, it's it. So at end of the day, money and whatever it is, it's all a negotiation. And you need to understand how much is a person actually willing to be, how much can you cost me for my laziness or my comfort? So there are a lot of things. It's not end of the day. You don't just tax, okay, petrol ka value itna hai, driver ka value itna hai. No, there are a lot of other factors also that you need to put in place. I hope that answers your question, Elon Musk. I'm glad I could, you know, answer you. Alrighty.
Do we have any other question or do we have any other participants? Because now you can come in. I think till we have someone ready, Elson, I want to know more about your journey in terms of how you got into the space of startups, and what do you think is like the biggest up or the biggest down that kind of changed a few perspectives about how you look at how this world works or this world functions.
Okay.
So adding this question only, can you also tell the newbies to how to like get to know about these things? Because there's nothing like a college or something that teaches like the engineers and those. So what can you say, like, what can you teach the newbies? Like, what can you tell the newbies about how to get started?
Okay, cool. So first, Saad wanted the story, how I got into startups. So I think I got like the first bug when I heard about... Okay, so for me, it has always been like, I've always liked the idea of money, the concept of money, in terms of, like, I've been very competitive. I like that winning mentality. So money was like this way for me to actually get something hands-on in my hand where I was like, hey, I want something. Or, you know, I want to, it could be anything, like just a sales or a negotiation or whatever. So I think the first time I actually got money for doing something was where I taught someone how to play football. And I, okay, someone, I'll keep it short, okay, because someone wants to actually present. Tarzan. So, and maybe I can, yeah, I think let Tarzan speak first and then I'll talk about myself. Cool? Yeah. Are you there? Tarzan, can we pitch now? Didn't register earlier. If you're there, you can unmute yourself and go ahead. Yeah. Hello?
Yeah.
Tarzan, you have unmuted yourself, but not audible. Okay, yeah. So I was saying, like, I always like that. So, oh, perfect. Come on, man.
Am I audible now?
Yeah.
Sorry for that. Yeah. Actually, I have an idea. Now, I recently read a post where an engineer said it cost around 700 to 900 on an electric vehicle for traveling for 1500 kilometers. He traveled during this COVID itself and it cost him around 700 to 800 sims. So it was fantastic. It's like if you take petrol, it will be around 9000 rupees if you calculate perfectly. If it is EV, it will be 700 to 900. So as everybody know that 2021 will be the era of EV. So actually, I had an idea, like we can do this same as a service, as a taxi of entirely electric thing. It will be cheap. It will be helpful for the nature. It will be easy for consumers as it will be using a very less price for us also. So that is it.
Okay, Tarzan. Good idea, dude. I think the teams are already working on that. The people abroad are all working on all of this. So electric vehicles, if they're coming as consumer vehicles, very likely they'll also come in as public vehicles and taxis. So yeah.
I think the closest one currently in the EV market that is spread is Mahindra, if I'm not wrong. Or Tata. So their rickshaws are coming in and they're coming up. Yeah. So Tata is coming in and there's another company from Ahmedabad called Savvy. S-A-V-E. Savvy Electronics. So those guys have some beautiful electric vehicles also. But the problem is, see, I use an electric vehicle. I think we built an electric truck for our waste collection systems and things like that. There are too many factors why it won't work as a commercially viable idea as of yet. Because there's a limitation in terms of how much you can go per charge. With petrol, there is no limitation as such.
Got it.
Anyway. Soon though.
We can develop those things as the new we can set up small charging points in each and every petrol pumps.
It's the time it takes to charge.
Yeah.
Okay. No. It takes around 60 minutes to come up to 80%. Means like I had one car. This thing is fast charging, but the base thing comes for 8. It takes 8 hours to charge completely.
Yeah. How? Yeah. 8 hours is what it takes. So it. How does it charge? Okay. Too many confusions and numbers. So there's no way to
In India, there is no such a system that like Indian Oil, they have the heavy petrol pump in the Hilly station. So it's highly differentiate that the. Electric.
Okay, guys. This is not here. We are not here for a discussion. I think we are diversified, like we are diverting from the original thing that this is Avatank. So guys, yeah, just to give you guys a small input, this is the actual prelims for the real Avatank live that's going to happen in front of investors. So if you're picking ideas, those ideas are for real investors. It's not just to figure out whether the idea works or not. So if you guys are working on something, that would be really interesting because these investors actually are pretty good investors. So you can always pitch those ideas and you guys can move ahead. But we can also do your pitching sessions. Hopefully we can kind of spare some time out of it eventually post the entire Avatank thing over, and we can probably practice pitches and see how those things roll eventually. Fair enough.
Cool.
All right. Do we have anyone else from the? Do we have like SUX Future, SOFO? Do we have any of these guys coming in?
No, I think we probably have to just stick with Cryptogram today.
Or do we push crypto tomorrow so that we can have like a cumulative thing with tomorrow's, or tomorrow we can register all of them together. We can host all of them together. If one of them is missing, we can always push it together so that we can have like a good day tomorrow. What do you say?
But Ashish, is that okay for you?
Yeah, I don't have any problem with this, but I guess bro, WhatsApp. I mean, dal dunga message saath bhai. I guess. वहां से मे भी सर लोग आ जाए उनको पता ना हो आज
No, I think I've already announced whoever's missed out. Then I think a lot of them, kind of Seven Sisters is already, I think, is a little busy. I'm not really sure, but theek hai, either way, what we can do is we can push, because the thing is it's only you right now. I would want you to kind of get in the momentum with everybody else also, so I would want it to be better for you. So I'm thinking we can push it towards tomorrow itself. What do you
say? No issues, koi dikkat nahi hai.
Elson?
Works for me.
Works for you?
Yes.
All right.
What do we do for the next because
what we can do is we can take a few questions if anybody has any questions. And
I think
then
that
we
works.
Can say thank you very much. And this time we were on time. So apne ko blame nahi karne ka.
Yeah.
Works.
Guys, if you have any questions, what you can do is you can text on the Avatank chat, or just give me your name. I'll call out your name and then you can ask. So just type your name and then I'll call you out, and then you can ask whatever question you have to ask.
Dr. Elson, can you like complete my answer? Like, I had asked about how to start things if you're a newbie, and that will be like great for all of you. Yeah.
Okay. Perfect. So yeah, so I was just telling about the story. Let me tell you how I started, because I don't like prescriptive advice. Everyone has their own journey. It's like some, I was just watching a podcast, you know, it's like success. Everyone has a different success journey. Not that I've achieved success, but yeah, fair amount of whatever. So I always felt this is the thing that I was saying, like I liked the idea of money in terms of it actually being like a reward. Like, for example, I bring in some value and I get something back. So when I was young, like third or fourth grade, I used to train people. Like, I was blessed with a little bit of speed, so then I could, you know, train people, show them some moves, and then they wanted to learn that. So I was being like, if you want to learn that, you give me some cash. You know, it's going to be like a tutorial, like a coaching class. Some people were, you know, they thought, hey, I don't have the money for that. I remember one guy, he actually was like, say, I don't have the money for it, so I'll give you credit in the grocery shop. So in Abu Dhabi, we used to have these grocery shops, and he's like, you can go and buy whatever you want, because I can't directly ask for money. Otherwise, I'll have to steal from my parents. So then I was like, cool, dude, fine. So what we used to do is like, I would train him in football, and at the end of the game, he would buy me like a Coke, a Red Bull. But I used to consider that an achievement. You know, I used to not. It was not for. I would go put that thing in the bank. I actually used to believe like that. So I used to go and keep those things. I used to keep that can with me, save it. I just liked the idea of it. That was like initial. And then later on, you know, so Abu Dhabi and my youth was like filled with football and stuff. So again, you know, we used to play matches. We used to you know, trade, and used to be like, if you win, so it was always like that. So I love the idea of money. I always wanted to, you know, be, it was a little bit of entrepreneurial, whatever you could call it. Then slowly I got into college, and in college I actually went for this internship to Vietnam, and I spent a month there. When I went there, like, I was dealing with a lot of internationals, people in US, England, and all of that. It gave me a, you know, perspective where I thought, like, in India, we spend so much time in studying and, you know, getting good at grades and things like that. But when I went abroad, I was like, bro, like, people were like, from the age of like 11, 12, they were doing these things, the exact same thing I was doing.
Yeah.
But they were doing it much well, and it was not different. I was like the odd one there. Then when I came back, I was like, dude, somehow I want money. I want a job. So then I started working at Pizza Hut. I was working at Pizza Hut while I was in college. And also I got into
University.
So I was in dental college. So I was doing my undergraduate. MCODs, yeah. So MCODs, I was... So studying there simultaneously, I used to go to Pizza Hut. So college used to be say from 8 o'clock to 4 o'clock. 5 o'clock, I used to go to Pizza Hut. 5 to 11, I used to work there. And also, I was like the vice president of a club called ISEC. It's a very famous club, especially in India. Like, not just in India, abroad also. It's like the world's largest youth-run organization or something. And I was like the VP of two portfolios there. So, I mean, that was like, on the left, it was, so I was experiencing different things, you know, like dentistry is in some way, like you're self-employed, you're building a skill, you're building an art form and things like that. You're increasing your own value and learning things. With Pizza Hut, it was like a complete job experience where I was working with, you know, different waiters, managers. I learned a lot from the manager there. So I learned a lot more that you can actually learn from an MBA just by working with this guy. It was my first boss. I think his name is Irfan. It was damn good. And on the side with ISEC was my entrepreneurship, or you call it pseudo entrepreneurship, where you feel like you're the next Steve Jobs. So back then, like, I had 50 people in my team, and I used to be like, bro, I'm like next Steve Jobs. So it was like practicing storytelling, public speaking. And, you know, we were actually selling, but it was not like we were not taking any money. All the money would be reinvested, and we used to build more things. The only thing that we got in return was the social capital, which was the social currency and the clout. And the second thing was basically used to get t-shirts and maybe for different conferences, which was sponsored. So it was like wonderful, but I was burning out like shit. You can imagine, like 8 o'clock to 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock to 11 o'clock, and in between that you have your and I was, you know, I had a social life also. So all of that was just I enjoyed it. I was like, yeah, I love this. Dental is hectic, especially because you have clinics and things like that. So I had to give up. Like, in fact, like after a point, I started puking and things like that. Like, I used to do running and all, but I couldn't train. So I started puking. A lot of stories. It's not important to, you know, rant about. But yeah, what point being, I was burned out like that, but I enjoyed it too. Then what happened is, at the final year of my college, I actually had to do like an internship. So we work in clinics as a doctor, and like, we get a stipend for that. So at that time, that's when I actually started to, you know, get a lot of, like, Pizza Hut, I was making 30 rupees per hour. That's more like, but yeah, you get the perks maybe of eating pizzas and Pepsi and all of that. But my first salary was actually 30 rupees per hour. And whatever money I used to make, I should just, you know, splurge at the weekend. But it was a beautiful feeling. I didn't do it for the money. Then what would happen is, and when I started getting a proper stipend in college, in my internship, I was getting like around 20K or something. And that is when I started, you know, to invest the money. So I used to study a lot of how to invest in stocks and things like that. But this money I was actually able to invest. So then I started thinking about personal finances. This much I'll invest here, this much I'll do here, this much I'll invest in myself and things like that. So I started becoming an adult. Then post college, I had multiple options, like three options to be in particular. One, I could go for my master's and, you know, become a maxillofacial surgeon because that was something I was passionate about. Number two, I could continue to stay in college as an undergraduate and work as a lecturer, get around 25-30K, work maybe for another 2-3 years while I'm actually figuring things out. And the third thing was abroad. Now, the going abroad plan was not too much, was not very interesting to me. And that's why like Varun comes in. Because Varun actually conducted like an event on our on Manipal. Back then, he just kind of exited with JobSpire, and this event was actually organized by Abhinav. So it was probably Abhinav's and Varun's first meeting too. So Abhinav organized the event for Varun. Varun came in as a speaker, and I came in as a audience. So and during that, like Varun was like, and they didn't know me. In fact, like nobody knew. I was just one guy in the audience, and then Varun started speaking. Back then, like Varun was like, not back then, like he's super cool, gave really cool answers and all. So I raised my hand and I asked him a couple of questions, and I was like, see, what's the point of, I'm thinking, cool, I'll work here and stuff, like, but if I go abroad, you know, the competition's better, they have better infrastructure. And then he told, dude, it's all what supply and demand, and there's a thing called purchasing power parity. And then I started looking those things up, and I was like, hey, this makes so much sense. So then I decided going abroad right now may not be the smart thing to do, and I decided to stay in India. And I mean, it gave me that thing, and it gave me that belief. Like, and he started speaking about freelancing, but it was still, I didn't know, I couldn't understand what freelancing is. I actually created a portfolio somewhere and tried running. I did like a data entry thing, transcribing job. I got some 1,500, but I never actually retrieved it. It's still there in that account. But yeah, this was like just exploring. And the point that I'm trying to say is, like, even though I was a dentist, like I was very different from my classmates, because I was basically like putting my feet into multiple buckets, exploring. While all my friends were like, abhi main BDS karega, uske baad MDS karega, uske baad main clinic kholega, like that. But I was like, no, dude, I don't think that's how life works. Right now, it's too early to, you know, figure these things out. We shouldn't have things figured out at this moment. So I was constantly learning. I also simultaneously, I figured at that point that you need to learn. So that's when I enrolled for like a diploma in C++. And I learned how to code, and I also learned how to do Photoshop. So all of these things, I started packing these skills up. And so, yeah, I built up a portfolio where I was getting noticed by people. And then after, and people started telling me, you know, you should actually meet Varun, blah, blah, blah. And I was like, okay, I'll meet. But then I was a little bit of a cocky bastard. I was like, bro, I'm damn good. That kind of a thing. I just left it at that. I was like, we'll meet and all that. But then I used to occasionally stalk Varun on Facebook, and he used to be active on Facebook. I used to stalk him, and just slightly stalking him. But then I was like, bro, our journeys are different. Like, I am a dentist, so I'll have to become a doctor and maybe become a big doctor there. And he is like this. When the college got over, I decided that I couldn't, you know, convince myself to actually go abroad or go for my master's or not immediately, because I wanted to, you know, do like an entrance exam. I was like, paisa dal ke, I don't want to get a seat. I want to do entrance. So then I was like, chalo, I'm going to study like a madman. So then I went for the coaching lessons, and that was another beautiful experience. Learned like a lot. So I used to wake up at 4 o'clock in the morning, take a cold shower, catch a bus. And there was like 3-4 hours of traveling where I used to actually go to a different place. So this place that I used to go to is called Thrissur. It's like the Kota of Kerala, where all the top entrance exam places are there. So I used to study like mad there. Pardon?
I feel like this Kota places and these Thrissur places, they've developed a lot of people, but there's also given a lot of people depression. Like it affects you psychologically very badly. Yep.
But if you're, I mean, I know where you're coming from, but for me, it hardened me. So it was like it was like beating a stone and turning it into diamond. So I actually enjoyed that pain. I used to have like, it was brilliant. I went through that phase. And I used to just do this thing where I was every day on the bus, I used to just keep singing, and I should keep, you know, motivating myself. That was around the same time this Ranveer Singh came up with that movie, Gully Boy and all. So I remember every time, and it's like bad, okay? I'm actually making it sound simple. It's like the buses are like horrible, where you're like literally squeezed. I have like huge, heavy dental books on me. People are stamping my feet. It's raining. There's mud. I'm wearing formals. And I'm trying to keep my personal burn rate really low, because, you know, I'm living on my own expenses. So, you know, that was like a beautiful journey. I just keep saying, apna time aayega, and I should just do that, like literally from the movies. This was going on one side. So this was the thing that I was doing to make my parents happy, because they wanted to see me as a doc, like a good doctor. On the side, I was like, bro, I can do something for myself too, which was basically, I started, my parents had like this lodge. I decided, so it came from that Vietnam experience where I was staying in backpacker hostels, and I was like, dude, the backpacker hostel thing, it was amazing, and I think we need to have it in Kerala or India also. So then I learned about Zostel and I was like, dude, I can do the same thing. You know, I can paint murals and graffiti on walls and I can interact with foreigners, whatever. So then what we did is I ran that Airbnb. I put it up on Airbnb, on booking.com, on there was Make My Trip, all of these things. And I started getting guests. And that's when, like, proof of concept. And I learned a lot about marketing there, like in terms of social media marketing, like, you know, hacks and black hat techniques and actually servicing clients. So this was a point when I was running the hostel, like it was me all in all. Like I had one helper, but if that helper was busy, like I used to even clean toilets, you know. So that was a point where I used to clean toilets. I used to do everything, make the beds, all of this. And I don't, my parents were all against this. So my dad actually had like a real, like he worked in Marriott. So for him to work there and then to see all of this, but then I was like, this is my hustle, bro. Like I need to do this for myself. Like my soul needs this. So yeah, it was a brilliant experience. And then, but people were all like, my relatives and all were like, bro, he's a doctor. He's qualified. Tell him to get the goddamn job. Just take a job. So then I was like, no, I need this. Let me just figure things out. So that was like a strong phase in my life where I was just, you know, doing all of this. And simultaneously at that point, you know, I started seeing a lot of my friends get jobs. So then I told my parents, okay, I'll do part-time. So I was working in a clinic also. So I used to go to 2-3 clinics and freelance there. Some of them wouldn't even pay me. They used to be like, you can come and learn from me, but no money. It's like, you know, unpaid. I was like, it's fine. I'll learn from you. I'll apprentice. So I, you know, was able to polish my skills. So I didn't give up the clinical side of dentistry. So all of this was happening. And then I was getting really good with my grades in this coaching institute. And at one point I was like, bro, I think I'm going to crack AIIMS, you know, and even NEET. And then what happened is, I gave the AIIMS exam. I actually lost it by just a margin. So I got like 230 rank, which if you just take the grand scale of things, I probably lost to the toppers in like, or the people who got selected in like less than 5 marks out of like 230 marks. So, I mean, I don't know if you guys understand this, but it was like, what I'm saying is it's kind of decent. Then what happened, Varun puts up this story and he's like, I used to run this company called Avalon Labs. Now I'm going to Avalon Meta. And if anyone, you know, I'm looking for some people to do this thing and run Avalon Labs. So then I was like puzzled, you know. I was like, hey, this guy is someone I actually looked up to and now he's coming up with this cool opportunity. So I was like, should I try this? Then my parents, and this was like 2-3 days before the exam, I told my parents something like this happening. So my mom was like, don't do this now, always keep doing this, you have studied 8 months, don't do this now. I was like, okay, I just told okay, but then I still applied for it, you know. I was like, chalo, try karega. There were some 400 people who applied, and then they got shortlisted to like 50, then to 12. And at the end, we had like a call where, you know, I spoke with Varun, and at the end of that call, like I saw the other applicants and I was like, dude, I'm getting this seat. You know, I'm getting, they're going to call me. I was like, I'm cocky. So then what happened, I gave the exam, but during the exam, pardon? Okay, yeah. So during, I couldn't like concentrate. I was just like, I don't know. I felt really confident. I was like, hey, bro, you know, when you land another job or a nice gig, you didn't feel like concentrating on the exam. Exam went well, though. I got a good rank. I could have got a good seat. The people I was studying with, like, she is now studying in one of the really good colleges and all, like my study buddy and all that. So the point is, like, at that point, then I was like telling her, all of them, you know, there was this point in my mind, I was like, I don't know if I should go for this or should I just go for college. But then, you know, there were these people who motivated me and they just kept telling, I think you should go with this. You can always come back to college later on also. So then I was like, hey, that's true. You know, even if I become if I go and explore a different field, I can come back. And so what most people think is I took a very risky decision, but for me, that was not risky because I believe that everyone needs to understand business and entrepreneurship to some extent. You need to know how to sell, you need to know it, you need to know how to talk. And I was like, let me learn all of these things from Avalon. And then I can maybe become a really good doctor after that too, when I actually, you know, want to practice surgery. Then I came to Avalon and then the journey has been very, it's been a roller coaster ride. I started working as my first job was like just servicing clients. So there was a guy who had to leave, like we were leaving a client, but then when I came in, they were like, why don't you take it up? It can be an experiment. So I started playing around with that. I did a little bit of copywriting, then got into performance marketing, started doing media buying, started getting, you know, good responses from the clients. They liked me. So then I was like, hey, this makes sense. So then they started giving me more and more opportunities. I took up a pro league with Abhinav, the first pro league. That's when we experimented. That went very well. Then I did my own pro league. That went fairly well. Then afterwards, you know, it's just been anytime I probably say it's like, if I find I can make myself useful somewhere, we exchange that conversation, get the opportunity, and then I try to make myself as useful as possible. So right now, yeah, I'm, you can probably know, yeah, been quite active in the community also, and we're doing the AML. So yeah, a lot of these things we're looking to scale, and so a lot of processes are coming in. So that's been my journey, or yeah, how do I say it? That's been my TED talk. But yeah, these are the things that I've done in the past. Looking forward to, you know, greater things. Hope you guys find someone.
I just wanted to add one thing to what Alson just said. It was something that kind of keeps pushing every story that I hear from someone who is always in a beautiful space. So the question was, how do you start? Right, Alson? And the funny thing is, there is a very simple answer to this question. You start by doing the first thing that needs to be done. You dip your feet. Like, it's impossible for you to know everything. Like, I know a lot of entrepreneurs who are trying to start out, and it's like, no, my research karega, I'll try to figure out everything that can go wrong and everything that can go right, and I do 10 months of research and this, that. You will never know. And surprisingly, the idea that you started with almost always is not the end result. Like, it's going to be somewhere far from it. And the only thing that you need to do is keep experimenting, like, just not stopping. I think persistently just going at it and failing constantly and learning and trying new things is the only way you can begin any journey. And 100%. This story about Alson is also about that, I guess.
I saw this talk, you know, it's like a magnet is there on one end and it's trying to attract you, but you don't know where that magnet is. Imagine that magnet or that force field is there, okay? And you are just trying to do whatever, and that magnet will eventually guide you to where you are. So you can call it whatever you want, fate or whatever. I know I'm sounding like a Baba, but I'm just giving you, like, imagine it's there and you start working. And I'll tell you two things that's different from me, or that makes me stand out from, say, others. One, when I came here also, so the first job, or when Varun actually hired, he was like, see, Alson, I don't mind giving you a whatever, but if I give you a stipend or a salary, what's going to happen is you're going to have this mentality that I'll be comfortable with jitna bhi le raha hai and I won't work. So he said, you come here and you tell your parents you're going to get zero. It's going to be a boot camp. You just come, learn for 1 year. Uske baad, you see whatever you want. So I was like, makes sense, dude. But then I was also like, you know, kind of wary, because I was like 24. And I was like, you know, maybe by now I need to start making some solid cash, you know. But I was like, chal yaar, ek bar, let's just give it a shot. I came in here also and I never work. I still don't work for money. Like, literally, I don't look at my bank account. It's like my expenses are sorted. Whatever comes in, it's like just a rainy day fund. I just don't look at that account. And I work for, like, literally whatever. It's just like pure out of joy. Like, it's even if I burn out on it. And even, like, when I was working here, I was an intern officially, but there was no contract. There's nothing official. It was just learn. So when I came in, I used to just literally be like, I'll sit next to the smartest guy in the room and I'll be like, hey bro, teach me whatever. And I'll do all the dirty work for you. You know, give me all the dirty work. So, like, you need to understand, I knew nothing. I didn't even know what copywriting meant. I didn't know what the word copywriting was until I came here. So I was like, you give me all your dirty work, I'll do everything. Like that, you know, they started offloading work on me. And as they offloaded, I started learning more. And so I would watch these courses, learn, experiment, practice it with the clients. And then I was able to implement that. And then eventually I was getting better than the people who actually gave me that work. So that's how, you know, start growing. And so, couple of things I'll say, don't work for money. I know it's cliched, but literally work. I'm not saying don't work for money in terms of don't make money. That's different. Make money, but don't work for it. You know, work for learning more. See yourself. Like, I still keep telling, I want to be this guy. And so I'm going to do whatever it takes to be that guy. If The Rock makes Instagram videos, IGTV or TikTok videos, I'll do it because I want to be like The Rock. Or if I want to be like Ronaldo, I will do whatever he's doing. And then I will rant and complain that God hates me. You get it? If I don't become Ronaldo or The Rock, I'll be like, that sucks. God hates me. But I will do whatever it takes to be like Ronaldo or Rock. You know, so that is the attitude you come in. So if you come in with the attitude, like a lot of people come in and they're like, I want to be a marketer. And I'm like, bro, what are you saying? You know, it doesn't make sense. You come in, you say, I'm going to do marketing. That's fine. I say, use the verb rather than the noun. Say, like, even if people tell me, like, are you a digital marketer? I'm like, no, I do marketing. That's different from, and because I keep, like, and another thing that I would say is, be stupid, you know. Don't assume that you know shit. Like, whenever anything comes in, I'm like, I'm the dumbest person here. So that's one of the reasons that I am actually, I have no biases towards my curiosity. If someone calls me stupid, I'm like, great, I'm stupid. But then I'll prove it to you with my actions, you know. So that is one way you can actually learn these things. And then someone asked that question, what is, how do you get into this? Dude, you binge watch. You binge watch YouTube. You binge watch books. You binge read books. You, for example, if you, I probably say I'm one of the biggest fans of Warren Maya, you know, because I know Meta Startup from scratch. I know Meta App from scratch. Like literally any video you ask me, I'll be able to tell you what's there in the content. So I know all of that. And I'm not pitching this. Like, I knew this before I came here. Before I came to Avalon, like, I knew anything about Varun. I knew everything about him. Like, literally, when the first conversation we had, it was nothing about work. We were talking about our college life, and I was asking him about, you know, other, like, random shit. Like, I can't even tell you right now. It's nothing related to work. Because I knew everything. Like, so we synced in a different level. So that is the kind of, you know, you need to put in that work. You need to obsess about it. And I realized, like, he's also exactly like that. If you talk about an investor, if you talk about a founder, he knows every shit about him. Like when we do our meetings and he's just so solid, he'll be like, this guy's telling this. And I'm like, he's so obsessed about that person the same way I was obsessed about him. You know, so be obsessive and, you know, those things are the basics. And the material or which book you read is just, you know, a simple Google search or a Quora read or asking people here within the community also. There's so many people are very smart. So yeah, that was my story. I think I'm going to shut up.
But on the other end, I would also try to indulge people into not being stuck on only the research end of it, but also implementing the research that you're doing. Don't become one of those people. Elson didn't tell you this, but he's probably one of those people who will learn and implement it immediately. Learn and implement. If you do not implement something, then everything that you know is just, you don't know the practical implement, like practically implementing any knowledge is so important. And I think that's something that I always want people to understand. Like, research is yes, but tum ground reality pe aake khelo thoda. Like, it's fun. It'll give you more exposure in terms of who you are as a person and what's your capabilities and what is your bandwidth and what's your threshold in so many ways when you start playing in reality. And it gives you
confidence.
And also there is,
it'll give you two things, yeah. Confidence, and it'll also, you will have I'm saying if you fail, no, what happens is you now have, it's that typical Edison quote, now I know 100 ways not to do it. That experience was exactly that. Like today, if you throw me out on the streets, I know I can convince people to come and stay with or a hostel with me. Because I cracked that Airbnb thing, you know, and I knew nothing. You know, one of the things that I was actually doing was illegal because I didn't register. You know, if you're hosting foreigners, you need to do something called a Form C. You actually need to do this thing called a Form C because officially to host an international is illegal. But I actually hosted 10 different people and it was like one of these days, one guy came in and he was like, bro, do you have a Form C? Because while you're actually, you know, enrolling these people to stay with you, they have to fill this Form C. This guy asked me, where's the Form C? I'm like, what are you talking about? He was like, dude, Form C, this thing. I'm like, oh crap. And I got so scared. The next day, I went to the nearby cop. There was a cop near my house. He was like, I literally rang his bell. I was with a shirt and tie. I came in and I'm like, sir, I'm doing this. And I said like this, okay? I was like, I have a friend who's running a hostel, doing some research for him. And he wants to host like a guest that's coming. And I put the story up and I'm like, can he do that? Then he's like, yeah, it's nothing. Just go to the airport and fill the form in. I'm like, okay, next day, quick, I take the bus, go to the airport, come back. So execution, yeah, definitely. You need to do these things. So like I said, if I had to do the research like what are the complexities involved in opening an Airbnb hostel, I'll never do it. Like, it's damn hard. Like there was this one issue, a cockroach was there in the house, and then the guest came to me, he put the cockroach on my face, like with the tissue, and he was like, dude, what is this? I'm paying like 800 rupees for this room and you're giving me this. And I was like, sorry. And then I had to, you know, be like, come. I took him all the way, took him on a rail. I paid for his railway ticket. I took him to the next best spot. But what I'm saying is, like, you know, there are so many complexities involved, which I didn't know. And if I didn't try, you would never know these things. You learn on the glow. You learn on the fly. In fact, like, I even picked up carpentry midway through because of this, because I started getting ripped off by the service people. You know, they started charging me like 500 rupees just to change a lock. And I was like, are you kidding me? Like, so then I had to learn carpentry. So you learn these things on the fly. 100% exactly what Sat said. If you start doing too much analysis and research, you will get into analysis paralysis. Yeah.
Is that a thing?
Yes, analysis paralysis. It's called when you have too many choices, too many options, and when you actually have to think of too many things, you become like a deer in front of you and you don't know what to actually do.
I wanted to say one thing before we end this, because I have to go now. The one thing that I very commonplace, like, people keep asking me, bro, tu itna cheez try karta hai. Like, I keep experimenting with like random things. Like on Avalon also, I've experimented here and there. And the moment I stop that experiment, and I'm always, people think that, oh, like, oh, this guy stopped it and this guy's not working on it. This parallelly, that result, what I've learned, has already been input into something else already far beyond you can already imagine. Right? Number one, I am not scared of criticism. Main haarne ke liye paida hoon. Like, I'm going to constantly fail to learn what is going to go wrong. You cannot come into this space from a perspective that you're going to win every time you hit it. Somebody asked me when, what is, like, can you start early? You can start early, but don't start early thinking you're going to be the next Elon Musk. Start early. Get a head start from wherever, however possible. Get it, and it's gonna change the way you look. So it doesn't matter what your age is. I'm sure Elson started early. It doesn't have to be a legit startup. I started early, as in I used to do events, like, very early on in my age. When I was 16, I used to do events in clubs where I wasn't even allowed to enter, because you need to be 21 to enter, right? And so there's a very common thing I've noticed, is where people are like, no, let's do research. And people go into this research phase. I get a lot of shit for this, but I keep telling people, listen, research has two perspectives. First perspective is, let me do research so that I can understand. So they do research to figure out whether they want to do it or no. Every time you're going to research an idea, I promise you there are going to be 100 things that's going to go wrong. And you start looking at it from a perspective of, let me figure it out if I want to do it post-research, you will never do it. You want to do research from the perspective of, I'm doing this, let me figure out everything that is wrong so that I can start tackling it as I go. Do you get the two different mindsets that I'm talking about?
Yep, actually I got that.
So it's very funny with these things. Anyway, on that note, we are going to end today. I'm going to end today. I don't know if Elson's still here for another. You guys can ask him another question, probably. Elson?
No, I'll have to leave. We're going to have the live. So I have to be there for that.
Perfect. Chalo, then we'll see you tomorrow.
Saad, hold on for a second. I want to share my screen with you. And I want कि एक बार तुम लाइक मेरे स्क्रीनशॉट देखो एप्लीकेशन के जो मैंने बनाया है, बताओ क्या कैसा है।
मेरा चार्ज बंद होने वाला है ब्रो। हाँ, तुम दिखा दो, जल्दी दिखा दो।
हाँ, जल्दी दिखाता हूँ, एक सेकंड। Not just from Saad, you know, कोई भी बता सकता है, कोई दिक्कत नहीं है। Okay. So maybe थोड़ा अलग लगे, बट मोबाइल में ऐसा लगता है मेरे को, बट तुम लोग बताओ क्या कैसा रिव्यूज है। So okay, hold on. So that's the logo of our company, okay? And that's the side options.
there be? Hello? Yeah, why did you tell me? Got it. You want some tips or?
In a sound.
Friends so in what... the camp. No, I didn't get your voice, man.
I'm really sorry.
The net
really
is bad on my end.
Yeah.
Let me just read
so, my question was that you have been in like you've been hosting guests into Airbnb, right? So you have an idea, vague idea of like how that thing works. So one of my friends is actually starting a campsite for tourists.
Okay.
And, like, what is the one advice that you would like to give when you're starting out? He has been in the hospitality industry. Then I'd be also like maybe joining him. So yeah.
Cool. Two advice. Like one, see, when I tell you this Airbnb thing also, I actually have like a background in hospitality. My dad worked in Marriott. He was an executive at Marriott. So he'd been working there for like 30 years. My granddad was also in a hotel called Meridian as a purchasing manager. So, you know, I was brought up with that. I knew how servicing works. So every 3-4 months, like I used to, you know, go to the, not even 3-4 months, short of that, like we used to stay at the hotels. I knew literally in and outs of what the business looked like. So, you know, servicing a guest, etc. I saw people do it, you know, or I saw it being happening to me, like how they treated me. So I knew what a 5-star treatment looked like. And then the backpacker hostel thing I told you, when I went to Vietnam, I understood how that works, where you don't, it was like an amalgamation of two ideas. One was the, you know, the chill vibe from a backpacker hostel, and the other one was like the 5-star vibe that I knew. So mixing both of that, that is where the sweet spot is, especially in these kind of places. These chill campsites or hostels or hostels, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But you need to be professional, okay? Even though it's like a very chill thing and you act, but you also need to be professional. Otherwise, it can cause a lot of issues in terms of your brand and all of that. What other tip can I give in terms of, yeah, beautiful. So Airbnb is a brilliant case study for a lot of things. So the entire team of Brian Chesky and all of them, the startup is... it's a brilliant startup example. I mean, Y Combinator keeps talking about them. Another reason why they're so good is because they're very innovative. You know, All the three people on, I mean, the two of them on the team, they're designers. So they understand how products need to be experienced. You know, there's a developer in the team, but the designers know how a product needs to get experienced. And that's what they, you know, thrive at. So Airbnb has two models. One is the Airbnb hosting, where you basically just host a bed and breakfast or the bed space. The second thing is you can also host something called an experience, an Airbnb experience. So Airbnb experiences are when you're teaching somebody like cooking or, you know, carpentry or pottery or whatever. So that is a very cool way to actually upsell your product. So one of the things that I actually wanted to do, or if I was planning to stay with the hostel even longer, what I was going to do is I was going to give them a bed space. And Airbnb, when they say bed space, no, I'm telling you, literally anyone can open an Airbnb, but you can just put up a mat on your room and you can sell it if you know how to do it, okay? Because they will have the opportunity to actually put a mat as what your bed is. You're not cheating anybody. Like literally, the person who comes in is looking for a mat. A lot of sites do this. Couchsurfing does it for free, but Airbnb it monetizes it. So you can literally sell just any con. You need to know how to do it. You need to make it presentable. That is one thing. And sell an experience. If you go through the reviews of Cochin Backpacker Hostel on Airbnb, I don't know if it's still there, but all the reviews, they'll have my name on it. They all say that the rooms are clean or the experience is okay. It's fairly affordable. But what they'll say is like, Elson was a brilliant host. He took, and I'm not bragging, like literally it's just the reviews that they put. So, and it was because of that, more and more people actually came in, because people come in for not the place, they come in for the experience. That is one of the things that you need to understand. Okay. Like, you know, if you're going to a 5-star hotel, if I'm staying at Hilton or Marriott, there I'm there for the beautiful sheets and the patchy chocolate that's kept under the bed and all of that, or the mini bar, right, and the room service. But when you're staying in an Airbnb or a normal Chintusa hostel, etc., I'm not there for that. I'm there for the experience. I'm there for the host. I'm there for all of this. So it's the same thing, man. I've stayed in this place in Pondicherry. I was stuffed in like three, four people. We were all together. I paid $800 just for a bed, and on that bed, literally there was hair. The people didn't even, you know, change the sheets. And I was willing to sleep there just because the guy who hosted me gave me a brilliant experience. I've done it same thing in Gokarna, where I've actually, not Gokarna, in Hampi. I slept on top of a terrace. I paid $500 just on a terrace. No fan, no AC, nothing. Just for that experience. So people will buy that experience. And if you can pitch your campsite or whatever as an experience, it's a lot more better. All right, guys, it's 7:05. I hope I was able to answer your question, bro. Need to hop off right now.
Thank you,
and we'll all see you tomorrow. Yeah, you guys. We'll see you guys tomorrow. I know today we didn't see any pitches, but tomorrow I'm sure we're going to have some really cool pitches. So yeah, please be prepared. I think Saad has left. I'm not sure. He's on.
No, I'm right here.
Right here.
Okay, Saad. So we'll meet up tomorrow.
Done. Perfect.
Bye, guys. Bye-bye.
Bye, guys. Ciao. Bye.